Ladies and gentlemen, good day and welcome to Aster Bioscience's Q2 and H1 FY22 earnings conference call hosted by ICICI Securities. As a reminder, all participants' lines will be in the listen-only mode, and there will be an opportunity for you to ask questions after the presentation concludes. Should you need assistance during the conference call, please signal an operator by pressing star then zero on your touchtone phone. Please note that this conference is being recorded. I now hand the conference over to Mitesh Shah from ICICI Securities. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Thanks, Vinay. Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to Aster Q2 results con call. We have the senior management, Mr. Rajeev Gandhi, CEO and Managing Director, Mrs. Priya Gandhi, Executive Director, and Mr. Nikhil Jhanwar, Chief Financial Officer, participating in the call today. I thank the management to give ICICI Securities the opportunity to host this call. Over to you, sir.
Good afternoon, everybody. This is Rajeev Gandhi here from Aster. As always, it's nice reconnecting with you like the way we do every quarter. Today we have declared the Q2 and H1 results, and the press note has also been circulated, and I presume that you have the details available with you as far as the press note is concerned. From my side, to give you a little brief on the functioning of the company in the last quarter as well as the first half year of this financial year. So far the year gone by in terms of first talking about quarter to quarter, in Q2, we have had marginal growth in terms of quarter to quarter business, while in terms of profit, we have done relatively better. The growth is 16% in profit as against 6% in the revenues. I would like to just share one thing with you that this growth of revenues, as mentioned also in our press note, the 6% growth, we have divided it into the three, which is poultry healthcare, animal healthcare, and other operating income, which include license fees and services. As the license fees and services in the Q2 in FY21 we had and we did not have any in this quarter. If you minus that, then our poultry healthcare has grown actually by 20% in this quarter, and the animal health division has grown 8%. Talking about half yearly results, overall, our half yearly results, we have grown on a half year same period comparison, we have grown by 24%. Similarly, if we look at the poultry healthcare and the animal healthcare, we have grown 34% and 22%, respectively. Overall, the sales has been good, and we further also have the sales bifurcation in terms of vaccines and health products. In terms of vaccines, our sale has grown 13% on a quarter-to-quarter comparison, while our health products have grown 31% on a quarter comparison. In terms of half yearly, vaccines grew at 26%, while health products grew at 53%. Looking into the composition of sales as well as our objectives as reasonably well-defined over the last period of 1 year to 2 years, wherein in every press note as well as in our talks, as well as in our annual report, we have been saying that we would want to focus on the health products, because the health products today we are relatively at a smaller level, and as already informed to you in the past, any animal health company, their vaccine business is always less than their health product business, while in our case it's the reverse. In a way, the potential to grow the health products is much, much higher, and that is being addressed by us at the moment and trying to take the health products business as much as what we can do. In terms of domestic sales as well as export sales, the domestic sales on a quarter-to-quarter grew at 21%. On a half yearly, comparison, it grew at 38%. On the export side, we have been facing a little bit of a challenge at this point of time, mainly because the international issues have still not fully resolved, and we have been selling mainly in the African continent as well as in the Middle East, where the flight movements are less. The economies over there are also still coming up with all these, trying to recover from the current COVID situation as well as their other internal economic situation, etc. So, keeping all these things in mind, though our exports have not been as per what we have actually planned or forecasted, we are still confident that in this year, by the end of the year, we would be able to recover, because there have been many investments made as far as Africa is concerned. Distribution network is currently being put in place. People have been hired. Marginal sales have been done, not that it has not been done. So overall, we feel that that the export business will grow up more so. Our Hester Africa plant would soon be functional, which I'll come later on. So all that infrastructure creation would not only help for the local Hester Africa sales, but it would also actually in a way lead to higher sales as far as exports from here are concerned. Besides the routine business, as what we have been doing in the animal health industry, the poultry health division, the animal health division, you all are also aware that Hester Biosciences has tied up with Bharat Biotech under a licensing agreement to do the manufacturing of the drug substance for Bharat Biotech at our Hester plant. The Greenfield project is currently under construction. We are constructing a state-of-the-art BSL-3 facility, and we have reasons to believe that this should turn out to be probably the best BSL-3 facility that our country has out of all the labs that are there at this time. And we hope to take and produce the drug substance from Covaxin to be supplied to Bharat Biotech. The capacity for the manufacturing of the drug substance for Bharat Biotech, we would be producing approximately 7 million million doses equivalent of drug substance to be supplied to Bharat Biotech on a month-to-month basis. Coming back to our core business of animal health, animal vaccines. Hester has been working towards developing the classical swine fever vaccine, lumpy skin disease vaccine, and the sheep pox vaccine. These vaccines are under trial. We have completed the technology transfer process from the Government of India. Out of the three, lumpy skin and sheep pox, Hester is the only company that has at the moment acquired the technology. So we have reason in India, so we have reasons to believe that we would be getting the 100% market share for these two vaccines. Lumpy skin disease is already an emerging disease in India, and at the moment we have a vaccine which is called the goat pox vaccine, which uses the same strain as lumpy skin disease. So we are in a position to give the goat pox vaccine for the usage of lumpy skin disease in cattle, and that is serving the purpose at this point of time. But hopefully by the first quarter of the next financial year, all these three vaccines would be registered and we would be able to sell all the three vaccines. On the health product side, we have, as you are aware, we introduced the herbal product range some time ago. This business is growing, and we are very optimistic on the growth of this business as far as natural products is concerned. Looking at our need and looking at for the vaccine demand, which is increasing day by day overall in India, we have embarked on two expansion programs. One is to manufacture additional bulk antigen and another facility for the fill finish facility. Both these expansion plans complement each other, because the antigen would be manufactured in one facility and the final fill finish would be done in the other facility. Both these facilities, once they are completed, it would more or less double our capacity what it is at this point of time. The antigen production should be plant should be ready by the fourth quarter of this financial year, and the fill finish should be ready by the third quarter of the next financial year. With this, we would have a huge, immense capacity, not only for the Indian market, but also partly for the international market. Last but not the least, we have been working towards introducing a pet healthcare division. Today, we are producing products for the production animals, all animals that are used by by human beings towards deriving an income, whether it could be eggs, meat, wool, etc. Now we also intend to get into the pet healthcare division, which would make us complete, the full product range for all animal health activities that are possible across. So that's it as far as Hester India is concerned. In terms of our subsidiaries, Texas Life Science continues to support Hester India by supplying us the health products. We buy from Texas Life Science and then we sell it in Hester. There, it has shown a steady growth as far as the sales is concerned. Yes, in terms of profitability, there seems to be a little bit of a marginal increase in the profitability, not much, but it is in line with our objective towards ensuring that this is like a satellite unit of Hester, and that Hester gets the product and Hester does the marketing and sales from all products manufactured at Texas Life Science. Hester Nepal, which went through a very bad time in the last financial year due to COVID, where there was no scope of any vaccine movement from Nepal to anywhere in the world. As you are aware, we have set up the Hester Nepal plant to cater mainly for the PPR vaccine to be supplied under FAO tenders. Things seem to be reviving. Q2 has been much more encouraging. In fact, the sale of Q2 has been much more than the financial year 21 sales in itself, thereby giving us an indication that things are now growing and that we will now take it further. Hester Tanzania is our trading and marketing activity. Things are slow at the moment in Tanzania, but I think with our plant coming up and with those even sales contributing, which also all would be routed through Hester Tanzania, we believe that there will be a good pickup on Hester Tanzania. And at the same time, goods also, we are looking at increasing the product range wherein we will export from here to Hester Tanzania. All this is happening, but the current economies in Africa are a little slow right now, recovering from various issues, one of them being COVID. But hopefully this all should kick up and everything should be back in order. Last but not the least, Hester Africa, our star project in Africa, wherein we are going to be manufacturing animal vaccines mainly for the African continent. I am very happy to inform all of you that we have taken the first three batches, commercial batches over there, which are under test at the moment, and we should get the release of all these batches sometime in the month of November, wherein we are looking at inaugurating the plant over there. Once that plant is inaugurated, we will start the sales also from Hester Africa. Because of this 1 year delay that we have had at Hester Africa, we are at the moment working towards making sure that the pipeline over there is hastened up and that we start introducing more products in our pipeline. By December, we have targeted to introduce three other vaccines at Hester Africa besides the current PPR vaccine for which we have already taken the three batches. So this is an overview of all the activities that have been happening at Hester and its subsidiaries. That's all from my side. Over to you all.
Thank you very much, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, we will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask any question may press star and one on their touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may please press star and two. Participants are requested to use handset while asking a question. To ask a question, you may please press star and one. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. A reminder to the participant, to ask a question, you may please press star and one. We have a first question from the line of Manish Gupta from Solidarity Investment Manager. Please go ahead.
Mr. Gandhi, there's so much happening in the company, you know, so many products that we are seeding, new geographies that we are entering, we are expanding distribution in India at the same time. So many exciting things are happening. Can you give us a sense of, you know, what this will translate into in terms of some broad numbers 3 to 5 years down the line?
Giving you broad indications in terms, one is that I agree there is a lot happening and a lot is happening in different areas, increasing the capacity, push on the distribution network in trying to increase the sales, notwithstanding the Covaxin project, etc. I do agree with you, and it's we all are reasonable. We are excited and at the same time working day and night towards making sure that all these things are achieved. In terms of quantification, etc., in nowhere in our forecast, etc., we are, you know, giving any figures as far as Hester Africa sales are concerned, because we would want to leave it that to Hester Africa. As we establish, it's the first time anybody would be producing a few types of vaccines over there and selling them. Yes, but of course we have our forecast and everything in place. In Hester Africa, at 100% capacity utilization, we should be able to do $25 to $30 million, which translates into around 250 crores of Indian rupees as far as Hester Africa is concerned, which should take approximately 4 years' time for us to work towards getting up to that level, 4 to 5 years' time. Talking about Hester India, we have projected that we would want to touch 500 crores in the next 3 to 4 years' time. So that is what our indication as far as Hester India is concerned. And Hester Africa is concerned.
And can you also provide some color on additions? We've in the press note you talked about additions made to the senior management team. Can you also provide some color of other you know, team members you have added to help you manage this growth?
One is, as today's announcement shows, that we have inducted Priya Gandhi as an executive director to try to steer a few things at that level. Besides that, we are expanding. We have taken people on all sides, you know, on the marketing side, on the finance side, on the technical side. In Africa, in fact, we have taken a local CEO over there. We have 17, 18 other employees that we have taken local from there. We have sent a few from here, less than 10 people have gone from here. It's difficult to exactly quantify and sit and give you a sheet that, you know, 10 people here, 13 people here, 20 there. It's difficult. But I do understand the growth and the people. There has to be in some proportion, and we are very conscious of that proportion, and we are making sure that all these things happen side by side. So that's, I mean, all that I can say. I'm not able to exactly quantify in terms of people, etc.
My last question, Mr. Gandhi, is that as far as Africa is concerned, how much of our growth in Africa will be linked to how, you know, economic growth is in Africa vis-a-vis development spending? Or development funding, sorry.
Africa is a continent for everything, whether it is vaccines, whether it is for infrastructure, whether it is for anything. There is a lot of dependency on grants, external funding, etc., quite a few. At the same time, if you really go to see, the animal population in Africa is very large. Tanzania, Ethiopia, Nigeria, even Chad for that matter, all these countries have a huge animal population. The current productivity of any animals in the African continent, in any country, would be very much more lesser than what it is in India, and even much more lesser than what it is in developed countries. So this scientific approach by giving vaccines, health products, is definitely going to be a big assistance to them. We will have to do marketing and try to reach right up to the down level wherein people start using them. We believe that there are two types of market. One is the tender market, which could be either funded by the each government or by big institutes like United Nations or maybe other international funding agencies. And now also there is a market that is emerging, that is a private sector, wherein there are more and more distributors coming up who supply up to the end level for the farmers, cattle farmers, poultry farmers, sheep goat farmers. So this is an emerging market. A lot of groundwork will have to be done by us, but the scope is huge as far as this is concerned. All our calculations are at this point of time 70% on private market and 30% on the tender market.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Anyone who wishes to ask any questions may please press star and one.
Hi.
The next question is from the line of Manish Jain from Gourmet One. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. I wanted to understand, we have been developing recombinant vaccines along with other products that we have under our development plans. If you can just give some insight as to when do you plan to launch these vaccines. And then I had a follow-up question.
We are working on certain poultry recombinant vaccines as well as cattle, mainly Brucella. Is also a vaccine on which we are working on. Brucella vaccine, we hope that it should be ready sometime in the next year. I'm not able to give you the exact date. Our work on the recombinant poultry vaccines, there are two products. Trials are ongoing at this point of time. And I don't have that data, neither have I any of those people sitting with me who could have guided me and I could have answered you at this point of time. But I feel that our Brucella vaccine should be the first recombinant vaccine which we should be able to release, and later on it would be the other vaccines. I am unable to give you the date at this time.
And my second question was on the CapEx plan. Now that Tanzania is more or less complete, and your expansion plans you highlighted at the start of your talk, if you can just give some insight on the CapEx plan.
Everything that has been for Africa, all that has been already completed, and there are some minor which is inconsequential. As far as our CapEx plan for India is concerned for these two products, it is about 50 crores. That has been all we have tied up for that. We would not be, we have tied up with the loans, etc., for this expansion plan, and that's what it is going to be.
And my last question was on pet care division. When we are talking about, are we likely to introduce vaccines as well for pet care?
In pets, we would first go in for the healthcare products and then for the vaccines. The therapeutics, just a minute.
Yes, Mr. Manishan, this is Priya here. For the time being, we are going to be concentrating on introducing some therapeutics supplements and dermatology products for the pet. And of course, in the long run, we would be looking at opportunities in the rabies vaccines, etc., for the in the dog.
Perfect. I had some more questions, but I'll join back in the queue.
Sure.
Thank you very much. Anyone who wishes to ask any question may please press star and one. The next question is from the line of Prashant Shah from Serum Institute. Please go ahead.
Hello.
So
I had a question regarding your Africa efforts.
Yes.
It's a new continent for us, and I know you have done a lot of work on it. Do you have any concerns regarding the acceptability of the product there, because it's something new? They may not have used, or they may not be aware of such kind of things. So there will definitely be resistance initially from the end user. So how are we going about overcoming this particular issue? And have you observed anything as such?
Yeah, okay. In Africa, the situation is like whatever is selling is currently being sold in relatively lesser quantities but at an extremely high prices, while there are some products and vaccines which are needed have not been sold at all till today, because there is nobody who is being producing them. We have taken it up as a challenge. Yes, it is going to be a challenge, but we have taken up that challenge to introduce these products, first vaccines as well as health products, and try to take the business forward. Challenges are going to be there. They will be quite big. We will have to overcome those challenges. But we have been talking to various governments in the African continent. We have given presentations at governmental level, sent information on what we will be producing, when we will be producing. So there has been many communications, correspondences directly with the veterinary, their national vet division or whatever they call it, the department, veterinary department, etc. And we have reasons to believe that all this at some point of time will translate into actual business, into demand, by way of which we will sell the products over there. Yes, but I must say there is a challenge, but after all it's business, we have decided to take on that challenge.
Okay. And after that, do you have any plans for the next level in terms of the markets? Because US and Europe are two big markets. So do you have any plans for those also?
At the moment, we would want to first stabilize all that we have currently been involved with, and then we will take up those next steps as and when. At the moment, there is no plan that we directly have for the American or the European market.
Okay, and coming back to Africa, so you said that your Africa capacity, Africa plant at 100% capacity should be able to do about 250 crores turnover in the next 4 to 5 years.
Yes.
What's the plan after that? Because that capacity, if the product acceptance is there, like we are hoping, then that 4 to 5 years may turn out to be a very short time frame and we may need to do further additional.
Prashant ji, abhi hum bol rahe the ke Pakistan, Africa is a market where we are not very sure and there are a lot of challenges. I think we would want to take this without planning after that. We want to take this for 2 years like this. And then once as we see the trend for 2 years, then we will want to talk about what will we do after 4 or 5 years. Because to be honest, our current focus is get this thing up, running, generate money, generate sales, generate profits. So that's what our objective is. We have yet to focus on what we will do after this reaches full capacity.
Okay. Thank you very much. That's my question.
Thank you very much. A reminder to the participant to ask a question, you may please press star and one. The next question is from the line of Aniruddha Shetty from Solidarity Investment Manager. Please go ahead.
Yeah. Hi, sir. Thanks for taking my question. I had three questions from my end. So you had mentioned about that CapEx plan that we're incurring of 50 crores. So what would the revenue potential be for that?
Okay. The expansion for the animal vaccines that we are doing over here, we are looking at near to doubling the current capacity of our plant at this point of time. It could generate a turnover, an additional turnover up to anything depending upon the product mix from 80 to 120 crores.
Got it.
Could be more than 120 crores. That's what my CFO is indicating to me. Yes.
Okay, this is clear. So my next question is on the pet business that we're looking to enter. So from a size perspective, a market size perspective and a growth perspective, we would share some insight around that. And also please, some details around the approach that we're, looking to take to, grow this business. Because, the customer is different, our supply chain might be different. So, how are we planning to, execute on that?
Okay. One is, in the United States, the pet market is the biggest market out of all the other animal markets. So that gives you an idea on the size of the pet. In terms of marketing, how we want to do it, it should be completely different from what we are doing. As I mentioned, that currently we are producing vaccines, health products for production animals, wherein people have a commercial objective in buying our vaccine. When they buy our Gumboro vaccine or the Brucella or Sheeppox vaccine, there is a commercial angle involved, because by giving the vaccine, the health of the host animal improves and what it is going to be getting in return out of that. So they are looking at the cost effectiveness of the vaccine. In pets, like in human beings, there is a high quotient, or the quotient is 100% emotional. So therefore, the whole marketing channel and everything has to be completely different from what it is as far as the current thing is concerned. I'll just hand it over to Priya to talk.
Yeah, hi, Mr. Anirudh. This is Priya. So, the pet market, since already the multinationals are already existing over here, but what what Hester is going to focus on mainly some products, what we know from our back-end market research is that at the moment, what many veterinarians do is that they give human supplements and human medicines with in a different dosage. So for example, if we as humans are prescribed 5 milligrams, for dogs they give it 10, but they use the same supplements that are given to humans. So what we want to do is we want to make it specific to the dosage and the dosage and in the presentation, for example, liquid, bolus, whatever that is more for a pet usage as opposed to what is given right now, which is existing in the human. So that's one of the unique things that we're working on at the moment.
Got it. And just my final question, which was on the just a broader poultry and animal health business. So in your presentation, you had mentioned you're introducing new products to grow this business. So are these products kind of new to market, wherein we are introducing something which is different from what our peers are doing? And just a broader understanding of just the growth of this business. So is this like our vaccine business today is quite underpenetrated. So from a penetration point of view, would the health business kind of be relatively be more penetrated? And would our growth be largely from just market share gains from our existing peers who are these MNCs?
Yeah. Okay. So, in terms of market penetration, we are actually per se more penetrated already on the poultry vaccine side. The large animal vaccine side, etc., is there is a scattered market where more penetration is needed. But on the health product side, the whole thing is that it's a very huge market and we ourselves are very small in this at this point of time. So that is something which we are focusing on, and we would definitely be able to gain more. In fact, in all my press notes talks, I have always told of a higher growth rate for these health products as compared to the vaccines. Priya would want to say something here.
Yeah, Sanil, in terms of penetration, I would just like to draw your attention that Hester, in collaboration with a Scottish NGO called Galmed, was one of the only organizations in the world, but more relevant to developing countries, partnered with them to give supply vaccines to the smallholder farmers in the rural parts of eastern region of India, and now we are trying to expand that. So what our endeavor through that project is, the project of course got over with Galmed in the 2018, but we are still continuing with a smaller division which caters specifically to the backyard farmers with smaller flock sizes, smaller animals in their backyard. And what we do is we have the thermotolerant vaccines of the Newcastle disease, which can tolerate or withstand higher degrees of temperature. So we do, we do these things. We do experiments such that we can, cater and penetrate more and more in the rural parts of India as well.
Okay. So would it be fair to assume that this strategy of ours, where we are going deeper into the markets, it offers us the opportunity to sell not only vaccines but also health products?
Hello, your voice is muffing too much. We are not able to hear it clearly. Can you just repeat, please?
Sorry. Is this better?
Yeah, this is better.
Clarify my understanding. Essentially, there's a big market. It's underpenetrated for vaccine, not only vaccines, but also there's a possibility of selling health products to those farmers, and we are kind of getting a sense of that based on the collaborations and the projects that we've done deep in the hinterlands of India. So the market is quite large, and the farmer can be sold a vaccine as well as the health product in some sense.
Yeah, absolutely. The market is, I would again break up the market into the organized poultry sector and the backyard poultry sector. Currently, India, in terms of organized, it up to around 90% of the market. So the penetration needed is very less over there. On the backyard poultry, India, we are totally, it is only 5% that is covered, and that market is as big as the organized poultry in terms of population. In cattle, sheep, goat, it's a completely scattered market, and a lot of penetration would be needed to be done, which all companies are doing, and the potential today of products to be sold in this market, leave alone for ourselves, this industry can grow more than 2 to 3 to 4 times if this market becomes as addressable as the market in the Western world.
Got it. This is very clear. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. The next question is from the line of Manish Gupta from Solidarity Investment Managers. Please go ahead.
So the question I wanted to ask was that, you know, we are growing our operation across India, and, you know, the value, the per dose value, obviously, of our products is very small. What percentage of our districts would we have salespeople, which at our current scale, you know, would actually be a loss-making territory just because we are still in investment phase? Would you track something like this? The question I'm trying to understand, essentially, sir, is that for the India market, is our are our margins actually far below what the margins could be because we are still in investment phase?
I mean, see, margins and penetration. Just a minute. Let me just mentally understand your question. Your question is what areas are either undercovered or covered at the moment, but wherein we are not able to make profit because we are trying to make penetration. Is that your question?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. What percentage of our revenue would actually be loss-making right now?
I don't think so that there is any area where there is loss-making area. Yes, when we hire new people, temporarily the average efficiency of the whole pool of salespeople does go down because somebody starting with zero while somebody already has 100 credit to that person's sale. So as we build up, there is always increasing the efficiency, but at the same time, we go on adding people. So this is an a continuous ongoing situation, but it is very difficult to pinpoint that Mr. A is incurring losses for Hester while Mr. B is making good profits. Ultimately, it is the territory and all the initial penetration and all has already been done. So today, if you take territory-wise, there is no loss-making. If we take individual-wise, I am sure at some point of time, there would be people who would be sort of, in inverted commas, actually making loss for the company. But then that's a phase which anybody, everybody in marketing sales would have to go through anywhere in the world.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Totally get that, sir. The idea was just to understand the amount of operating leverage in the business. So this is very clear. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. The next question is from the line of Hirsch, an individual investor. Please go ahead.
Yeah, do you have any plans for QIP? You had mentioned a few quarters ago. So have you firmed up any plans regarding that?
No, not at the moment. We have been able to raise finances through internal accruals, through banks, institutes, loans, etc. So at the moment, we are still QIP has been proposed for an acquisition, which we are all the time looking for. If we do get an opportunity to acquire something, yes, we will trigger that QIP method, not till that time.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. Anyone who wishes to ask any question may please press star and one. The next question is from the line of Arnav, an individual investor. Please go ahead.
Hello. Thanks for the opportunity and thanks for the great result. I had a couple of questions. Most of them have been answered. So on the pet division, I think Mr. Gandhi had outlined, you know, some of our thinking. Is there a revenue number that you're also looking at from a, you know, 2 to 3 year perspective?
This division is in its formative stage. It would not be possible for us. We are yet forming all these things, the revenue model, etc. For the pet division, it is too early for us to give any indications on this.
Okay, that's very helpful. And is there any timeline to get it started, or it's already, you know, you put it in place and the products are out in the market, or there's
a
lag?
No products are out in 1 year's time. We will come at the moment. We are studying, we are looking, we are trying to look at various products, choosing, shortlisting, packaging, designing, because this marketing is very different from the current product marketing that we are doing. So I think you can give us 1 year's time by the time we launch products.
Okay. And the last question was linked to the revenue. So you'd mentioned, 250 crore for Africa by, in 3 to 4 years, if everything goes well. And similarly in India, we expect to hit 500 crore sometime in 2024-25. Is that the fair assessment? That if we add those up and things go well, then we'll be around 750 crore at a consolidated level in 2024-25?
Yep. Yeah, your voice is muffing, but as I understand, your question is that adding the two, would that be right? Yes, because the forecasts over here are different from the forecast of Africa. So at any point of time, both would have to be and should be added. One doesn't, we are not talking of overlapping.
Okay, that's very helpful. And thanks so much. And best wishes, Vicky. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Manish Jain from Gomal One. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. This question is mostly for Nikhil, where, Nikhil, we are looking at, you have earned 38 crores of EBITDA in the first 6 months this year. And so on an annualized run rate of 76 crores of EBITDA, and Rajiv just mentioned a 50 crore capex plan and a current debt to equity of only 38%, because your net debt is only 95 crore. What is the max debt to equity that you all will be comfortable with?
So overall debt equity that we are looking is maybe 60 to 40%. That's 60 to 40 is what we are looking at as a debt equity ratio with the new capex and all coming in.
So 60 of debt and 40 of equity.
Yeah.
So that means you can actually technically do upwards of 200 crores of acquisition, should you want to, without diluting equity.
Yes, Rajiv here. What you have understood is absolutely right, and that is the maximum that we could be wanting to go, or we could go. But the path towards it would not be first this small thing that we are doing over here. If we get an acquisition, if we get anything that we can acquire based on the size of it, how much money we would raise and how much of debt we would take, and that is the way we would want to go further. Taking debt, working hard, repaying it off is always better than any other way of financing. But this he has given you an outer limit.
Perfect. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Anyone who wishes to ask any question may please press star and one. As there are no further questions from the participants, I would now like to hand the conference over to the management for closing comments.
Thank you everybody for hearing me out, as well as I hope I have been able to satisfy all of you with my answers. As I always say, there are times when I'm not able to give a satisfactory answer up to you all. One is that I may be lacking information. Two, that due to whatever statutory reasons, I might not be able to say certain things. So besides that, I hope you all had a satisfying Q&A session. Looking forward to catch up with you all again in our next call, which would be in the next quarter. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Participant, on behalf of ICICI Securities, that concludes this conference call. Thank you for joining us, and you may now disconnect your lines.